It's a holy thing to be wild and free, like a raging storm on the calm sea. Lord, heal my heart until my heart believes that it's a holy thing to be a sacred space to be lost in one, to safely rest in the mystery. Lord, fill my heart until it's full of hunger. It's a holy thing to be with hearts that are open, just as wide as the sea. It's a holy thing to be wild and free. Yeah, yeah. Cause I got his wild, I got his full of mystery, I got his freedom, I got his full of destiny, his love has borders that ours will never reach. It's a holy thing to be wild and free. We are shaped and formed by the hands of God. No eye, no death could ever separate us. The greater the distance, the greater the love. It's a holy thing to be wild and free. With a heart set open, just as wide as the sea. It's a holy thing, it's a holy thing to be wild and free. It's a holy thing, it's a holy thing to be wild and free. It's a holy thing, it's a holy thing to be wild and free.
Amen. Yeah. Man. What a blessing, huh? Our God is wild. Our God is full of mystery. Our God is freedom. Our God is full of destiny. I wrote that line, Eugene Peterson says, destiny. It's like an area that God makes for you to farm, but it's so big you never reach the borders of it. But like, you know, all children, he says, we need to know where we're supposed to farm, to Tell me what to do, Dad. Tell me what to do, Mom. Where should I go? Where? And Eugene so beautifully says, destiny is, that's destiny, that God creates a borderland that you can't even reach the borders of it. Somehow mysteriously, you operate with so much freedom because you know, oh yeah, I'm bordered in. His love has borders that our hearts will never reach. Go on, wander a little. You know, this is it. I love that. Isn't that beautiful? Turn in your Bibles just to Matthew 17. I want to start by reading a poem. And in the earlier service, I went really fast. And the worst thing that you can ever do to a poetic type is rush. Because I felt like I was like going like this. And then another thing, you know what I mean? It's like, oh, Lord have mercy. There's this beautiful poem written by someone, I can't even name the person because it's anonymous, but it's one of the most beautiful poems I've ever heard written, in particular for me, on the subject of being followers of Jesus. Yet I don't even know if the poet had that in mind. Just mysteriously, it's one of the greatest poems on worship and what we do often as a church, waiting on God to come. It's called Breathing Underwater. It says, I have built my house by the sea. Matthew 17, if I didn't say that already, you know. I built my house by the sea. Not on the sands, mind you, not on the shifting sand. And I built it of rock. A strong house by a strong sea. And we got well acquainted, the sea and I. We became good neighbors. Not that we spoke much, we actually met in silences, respectful, keeping our distance, but looking our thoughts across the fence of sand, always the fence of sand, our barrier, always the sand between. And then one day, and I still don't know how it happened, the sea came. Without warning, without welcome even. Not sudden and swift, but a shifting across the sand like wine. Less like the flow of water than the flow of blood. Slow, but coming. Slow, but flowing like an open wound. And I thought of flight. And I thought of drowning, and I thought of death. And while I thought, the sea crept higher until it reached my door. And I knew then, well, there was neither flight nor death nor drowning, that when the sea comes calling, you stop being neighbors, well acquainted, friendly, at a distance neighbors, and you give your house for a coral castle. And you learn to breathe underwater. Isn't that beautiful? The question often is, where is God? Even you can hear it in our worship, in our songs, where is God? We may not say, where is God, but that's what normally we've been saying. Where is God? It's interesting that in the beginning, Adam and Eve hid behind the bushes, right? in their shame. And it's interesting, it's always been interesting to me as a worshiper that from the very beginning, the question has never been, where is God? I actually learned this from Abraham Joshua Heschel, the great poet, prophet, philosopher, walked with Martin Luther King, marched with him, wrote one of the greatest works on the prophets ever, wrote some of the greatest stuff on glory ever. That idea of where is God? The question is not where is God. The question's always been where is man? Where are you, Jason? I want to walk with you. Where are you, Jason? I want to take your hand. Where are you, Jason? Will you come walk with me? Humanity's always had this tendency to distance ourselves from God and then blame God for the distance. God's the one with the relational problem. God's the one. We're waiting. We're all singing, waiting on you to come. Yet when Jesus comes, right, the indication is not that we're all waiting around, waiting on God to come. The indication is, even from our response to Jesus, is when God actually comes, his presence terrifies us. It's not terrifying for all the reasons that we might think, because we're scared of him and he's just so powerful and we're all like terrified little shrimps and he's gonna crush. If it was like that, it'd be much easier to explain, but it's way more beautiful than that. His way, his poetic way, his sense of waiting, moving away from all the things we think he should be moving toward. You should be moving toward that, Jesus. And then he just moves away from it. I mean, the entire new creation, right? Me and Charles learned this from the blind Jesuit Father Larry Gillick when we were on retreat together. The beauty of that story of Cana being the new creation. There's six pots, there's 6 days of creation. He's filling it up. Mary's the new Eve, right? Instead of listening to the voice that says, don't do whatever God told you, she's saying, do whatever he says. There's water, there's creation, right? There's space. We're terrified of space. That's just the truth. I'm terrified. Artists are terrified of space. We want to fill all the space. Oh, God, please don't make space. Especially like people moving out and leaving. We're so insecure and we want to fill up the space. But Merton taught us, if we just realize that God always makes space when God intends to hover over that space with the presence of the Holy Spirit and make something new. We're terrified of space. I'm terrified of space. I don't like space. It's the discipline to create space. Even when I'm leading worship today, I go to the guys, okay, you know, sorry, Charles, I want to do even better with making more space. The next service while I'm leading, I want to make more space. I don't want to fill up space because I can't hear anything when all the space is full. Come on. Great word. I heard an older woman on prayer a couple months ago. I went to this intellectual conference, and the whole time I was wondering, why am I even here? I didn't understand. I mean, I feel pretty like red and I didn't understand anything. And all of a sudden this old lady got up on prayer and she said, you know, some of you are so afraid to sit silent. And some of you think that when you enter in silence, that it's the absence of noise. I mean, like only a 91-year-old prayer warrior could say, right? She says, I mean, no, I could never think of this in 1,000 years. That's why I have to tell the story of her, because I don't even pretend like I came up with this myself. Oh, but it's so much better than that, she said. Silence is not the absence of noise. Silence is just the absence of all the noises that want something from us. So from the very beginning, we distance ourselves and we blame God for the distance. And I think it's because the very presence of Jesus, it terrifies us the same way it terrified the disciples. To follow Jesus, this is a much more scary thing than to just sing about following him. To create songs about, I'm going to follow you. Like today we're singing, I'm going to trust you. It's like, no, that's easy. The expression's the easy thing. It's the activity that's the hard thing. If we started actively pursuing everything we sing all over the world on any given Sunday morning, it changed the world instantaneously. And I actually believe that God is waiting for that activity. And it's activity that gives us, it's the activity of a worshiper listening to the heart of God that gives us the courage to break through rooftops, right, of expression. Caps that we've placed on expression that we would have only gotten those rooftops had somebody been courageous enough to break through that rooftop and show us that there's something. But you can't do that if you're not active in your worship, because it requires courage that only comes through learning how to trust the hand of God. That there is a God who sees right where you are. Just like the act of worship to forgive, to make the soil new again. How do you forgive 70 times 7 if there is no God? Heschel taught me that justice, there is no justice if there is no God. Why? Because it's impossible to forgive 70 times 7 and not after, you know, when is it? When's the math? I'm terrible at math. Remember me? Is it 9 times in that you start giving up and think, what a fool I am to keep forgiving? The only way we can forgive as Jesus calls us to is if there's a God who's real and alive and we can hear his name and we're taking his hand. Boy. You become active as worshipers. I always tell, for years I've told my friends that come with me on the road, I'd have, you know, I remember years ago, even here, I'd have Micah sing a song, or I'd have, you know, Brian Willard would sing a song, you know. Remember, I mean, I just talked to him. It's just, some of it is funny too, you know. And I remember they'd always say, well, what should I sing? And I always would just say, man, you're such an active worshiper. Sing whatever you want to sing. Why? Just bring the activity of your worship into your expression. Man, if there was a worship movement around the world, that activity was the goal, man, expression would explode. More than we think that we've come to the place of incredible, like, we haven't even started. There's so much more. We live in a day that if I want to find the poet, I love poetry, but if you want to find poetry, you got to go through like a very long line at Barnes & Noble of self-help and all that. It's like, yeah, the poetry section, it's like somewhere back by the jazz music. You know what I mean? We just hide this stuff. It's some of the greatest stuff for our, especially each nation. It's like there's people that give language, right? That have a way to express things. And anyway. But this is, I believe, really the context for this passage. Because all around this passage, the disciples, they really, let's just be honest, all around this passage, and you study it out yourself, they don't really get what Jesus is doing. Especially Peter. It's like, what are you doing? And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun. And his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And this was a huge moment, even for Peter, who was questioning Jesus on everything. The law and the prophets show up and they're talking with Jesus on the mountain. And then Peter says to Jesus, Lord, it's good that we're here. Which is crazy because Peter hardly ever says that in the Gospels of something that's going on with Jesus. Oh God, it's really good that we're here. It's always like, why are we here? What are we doing? Shouldn't we be doing this? Shouldn't you be doing this? Where did you go? But Lord, it's good that you're here. And if you wish, I will make three tents here. One for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. And he was still speaking when behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them and a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. Or even, this is my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. And when the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, get up and don't be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw only Jesus, right? And that doesn't really make all that much sense without all of that context. Why does the father get so mad? I mean, Peter's just trying to make tabernacles to honor the presence of these incredible Moses and Elijah. They're our heroes, and Jesus, you're here. We get you here. But God heard the distancing of humanity. You could stay here. We'll go back down. This is good. We could bring people here. They could see you. They would get this. He doesn't say it, but he's basically saying, you've been kind of freaking us out with some of the stuff you've been talking about. Half the time, we don't understand. You do a massive miracle, and then you get on a boat to go somewhere by yourself, and we have to follow you around to find you. The other day, you didn't even have breakfast. This is this type of tension. You're so whimsical and so out of the norm, and you turn this way, and you're led this way. We can't even figure you out. Just about the time we think we got it figured out, and we definitely know you're going right, you go left. We could get acquainted with you here on this mountaintop. We could become good friends, incredible, friendly, at a neighbor, distance kind of neighborly friends. We could come visit. We'd bring all sorts of people here that would get you in this space the same way that we get you right now in this space. You could stay here. And they're overwhelmed by the passionate heart of the Father for his son. Hey, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. Don't just sing about trusting him. Take his hand. I remember years ago, the first season when I finally, as an artist, and I speak to all of us really, because Eugene Peterson says so beautifully, you can't even be a Christian if you're not an artist on some level. Now that sounds funny because some of you don't think that you're artists, but you have to tap into some level of imagination to access the life of faith that's required to be a follower of a living Jesus. But just like we try to fill up all the space, sometimes I remember even as an artist, you feel good when you finally understand yourself. Because for me, it was years. I never understood myself. I mean, the first record that we did, the Faith record and Key of David, we made those records for about $800. It was just like this. Turn on the recorder. Then turn off the recorder. And then that was it. That was the records. And then we put them out and they're going all over and people start having me in. And I have no idea why they're having me in. And to this day, when I listen back to those recordings, I think, why would anybody ever listen to those? Just listening to myself as an artist. Because that's artists. And there's moments where you arrive at a mountaintop experience where maybe it's your first one and it's just like a little bit of a hill, right? And but you think it's a mountaintop because you've never been on a real mountain in your life yet. And so it's huge and you journeyed all the way up that hill, right? And there you are standing on that hill and you're looking back at where you come from and you're looking forward at what's ahead of you. And it feels so good because you have this sense of, oh, it's good to be here. I finally get it. I get where you've been taking us, Jesus. I get it. Oh, so good. You get up a few of those, maybe you're on a very tall mountaintop, maybe there's a big old ledge. And you get up and you know maybe you're on your third one, right? You're like 30, you have a few kids, you're changing their diapers, you know. You're writing songs, just trying to figure out, where am I going? Where are you leading me? What should I be writing now? Have I written any? You know, you're going through all those processes and Jesus is always up for more of a journey. Hey, you want to go up to that mountain? Sure. I'd love to go up to that mountain because I'm just enough of a crazy artist to just take Jesus up on it. Sure. And I remember growing up with, who is that guy? Indiana Jones. Yeah, because I said earlier, thanks, John, for saving me with that. Indiana Jones. I remember Indiana Jones, it was always like, faith was like reaching out on some rock wall and then you'd like finally hit this secret spot and, or they'd accidentally fall into it and it would just, they'd move something and then a magic bridge would appear and you'd just walk across this amazing magic bridge to the next place. And I don't know why, but my thinking when Jesus would say, hey, you want to go up to that mountain? I was just thinking, if I have enough faith, and if I believe in you enough, Jesus, I'll just step out, right? I'll step out and a magic bridge will appear and we'll just walk across to the next. You can call it a mountain. You can call it a new level of glory, a new space, growing, right? Expanding, being added to. And I remember the first time, and I knew it was the Lord because you can't Google this and not find me say these words. That's how I know. You know, it's like I didn't read these somewhere. It was just I'm sitting there and I hear almost a chuckle in my spirit, and it just, hey, Jason, that's not how we get up to that mountain. There's no magic bridge. Bridges are man-made. I didn't make bridges from mountain to mountain. I made valleys. Do you hear that here? It's good for us to be here. We finally understand where you've been taking us, what you've been saying all this time. Moses and Elijah are here. This is good for us to be here. Shh. Listen to him. Your ultimate act of worship, Jason, is to listen to Jesus. Take him by the hand. Let him lead you. Don't just say it with your mouth. Really trust him. Take him by the hand and let him lead you, not into that magic, right? That magic. No. Into something way better than magic. Let him lead you into the reality of mystery. A place where you'll grow by just taking a step down and letting him lead. Because new levels of glory are always a step down before they're a step up. And that's why we wouldn't, you know, that's why they're hard to sell. Unless you can surround them with certainty. For $10.99, you can buy a new level of glory. It just doesn't work that way. You have to step down and take the living hand of Jesus that meets you and I right where we live and says, don't distance yourself from me anymore, Jason. I want to walk with you. That's the ultimate act of worship, isn't it? Walking with Jesus. Don't be afraid. You're acting like you're afraid. That's your way, humanity, of staying in control. Acting unworthy, acting ashamed, hiding. Come out from the hiding. Even artists, I feel it, you know, you just pray over people. Just be what God called you to be. Just write. One of the great writers of our time is James Bryan Smith. He wrote An Arrow Pointing to Heaven, the great work on Rich Mullen's life. He's written many of Foster's spiritual direction stuff. He just wrote a book a few years ago called The Good and Beautiful God. What a great book. And I remember hearing this story. Philip Yancey outed their whole writing community. Eugene and Philip and all these guys in this book called Now and Then about Henry Nouwen. And Brian was just James Bryan Smith was just a young man, a young kid that wanted to learn how to be a writer, felt like he had a gift to be a writer. So he wrote all of them. Said, hey, can I come and learn from you? Have coffee, sit down with you. Can you teach me how to write? And writers are, well, they're a recluse kind of tribe, you know, and their time is important to them. And so beautifully, you know, Yancey tells this story so helpful to us. None of us said yes. We all said, no, we're busy. We didn't know who he was and all these things, you know. And then he says, but of course, Henry. Crazy Henry says, if you want to learn to be a writer, James, why don't you come live with me? So he comes up to Daybreak in Toronto and lives with the community for a month and a half. And the first thing that Nouwen did was he said, what I want you to do today is I want you to, you come to Mass, you pray the prayers, get on the rhythms, and then I want you to spend a few hours every day just writing. So James comes back to Henry with his great, like, thoughts and work, you know, and write, you know. Hands it to Henry. Henry, there's red all across all the things that he thought was great, right? Why are you crossing out all that stuff? I thought that was amazing, Henry. You're never going to learn how to write if you're trying to write something great. Wow. Don't try to write something great. Just write. Just start with, I had some milk this morning, and then I did this. It's like the breath of God, isn't it? But what we do is we lock worship so much into an expression. We're terrified. We don't learn how to write. And we even can lock ourselves in such a way that I find with a lot of artists, you get into almost writer's block because you're trying to write something within a particular. I'm even sometimes trying to write the songs that I've already written. And so I'm just stuck because I'm trying to write myself. I'm trying to write what I've already written. And it's like, oh. You just keep throwing. You get the point. And you may not. And there's grace for that too, because half the time I don't get the point. I want to walk with you. And I want the activity of your worship experience to make its way into your expression. I believe that we're living in a time that we're going to see an explosion of expression. Yes. I don't believe that we have to, well, I believe that we're going to see an explosion because I believe we're going to see more activity in worship coming. I feel like we've come to a certain place with expression. And even the greatest among us of worship leaders knows that there are things that are missing. There's courage that's missing to take us to the new place. One of the great, and just give me five more minutes. I'm sorry I've taken so long because the worship was longer and then I have to like speak so slow. I speak like John Wayne sometimes. I mean, it's like, I even listen to myself. I understand it, but just give me just, and I don't want to, this is your Sunday, so. But I've wanted to say this because I don't think anybody else is really going to talk about it, frankly. But there's a lot being said right now about narcissism in worship. And I think there's a lot of truth to it. There's so much me-centered worship, I suppose, in some ways. But the half-truth about a lot of times what's being said from the sound waves of Facebook and things like this is that you can eradicate narcissism by taking the word I out of your worship. But that just doesn't sit for me. Because you're going to have to eradicate most of the Psalms to take I out of your worship. It doesn't work. But there's something true about it because narcissism isn't the goal of our lives as followers of Jesus. The problem isn't I am in worship. The problem isn't finding God alone in all things and then bringing that to your expression. The problem isn't the worship that Jesus calls us to is not watch me, follow me. No. The worship that Jesus calls us to isn't even songs about following Jesus. The worship that Jesus calls us to is following Jesus. Let our song arise alive with that kind of activity. The problem with trying to take the I is you're trying to create this scientific, yeah, just keep it all about God. Just keep it all about God. Oh, God. God. So a bunch of kids just got shot out of school down the road, and we almost don't even, we could never write a song about that and lament. Why? Because there's not enough I am in our worship. That's why. Why is I am? I want to feel the pain of God for that. Why is that happening within our communities? And then we're not just going to escape and go, God, you're so amazing, even though that happened. So sorry. We're praying for you. Oh, God, you're amazing. Let's ignore the pain. No. And it's not let's worship pain. This is what Merton said. He said, we don't worship and pray and long for pain and suffering. Just to be clear, to long for suffering, to believe in suffering is his exact words, is pride. But to find and believe in God in the midst of it, that's humility. So what do we want to do? We want to get our hands dirty in the soil of this new creation. And we want to come out, what? With expression. Why? Just because we came up with a cool song or we make a depressing country song or something about kids dying. No, that's not the goal. But the goal is to center ourselves deep enough in the I am that we come out with an expression. Right? That's sad in that and loud the I am, right? To deepen. The goal to get rid of narcissism, this is Vanier and now and all these guys, is what? Go be a part of community. Saturate yourself in such community and find God in the midst of that community. And also find a God that right from the beginning with Moses, Moses says, who should I say to the people? Who sent me? I am who I am, and I will be who I will be. My presence is active. I'm alive. Yeah, I'm going to do spontaneous things among you. Why? Because I'm active. And what is God longing for from us? Activity. You want to eradicate narcissism? This is how Mother Teresa said. You want to eradicate narcissism from your life? Go home and serve your children. And then in the process of serving and raising children, write the God that you find in those moments and then write expressions. Now, you remember 30 years ago, praise? Because we needed some praise, didn't we? You know what I mean? Because when I was growing up, there was like no praise. And then we got a little bit and it was like, and you listen back, you're like, wow. But guys, you can't say, hey, we tried lament once in church and it was so horrible, nobody wanted to come back because it was just terrible. That's not a good excuse to not write great lament. Just because it was terrible. We got to give ourselves to it time and time. Somebody read a poem that they wrote in church, and it was so bizarre. It just left us off in the middle of nowhere, and we never got back home again. If we believe that, we're just gonna sing pop tunes until eternity. But I guarantee you, when we get into eternity, there's going to be seasons. There's going to be winter and spring and summer and fall. And there's going to be gardens that are going to have to be toiled. And so, why? Because God created this all for us to be workers in this place. And this, it's not like, hey, 67 is my favorite temperature. That's what heaven's going to be like. And that's a lot of times, I think, what we're doing with our worship. And then we lock our worship artists into that. I believe God's saying, no. What you want to lock your worship artists into is, do you pray?
Come on. So cute.
Are you following Jesus? What's God saying to you?
Come on. Good worship.
And Jesus is reaching out to us saying, man, let the activity explode. One last little thing. David White, just to push back on that just a little bit more, and then I'm going to pray for you guys, and then Charles is coming too. But he's going to land all of this. It's going to be amazing. I remember one time I was on a panel with, who's that guy? Larry Randolph? Oh, yeah. And I'm on this panel discussion that they have me on, and I'm young. I'm so young. And I'm just reading all these, like, mystics, you know. And somebody would ask me about, like, music. And they really just wanted, like, oh, yeah, it's amazing. I love being in front of, like, people, and the glory is awesome. And, you know, and I said some mysterious thing. And then Larry would say, let me land this. And then he'd ask me another question. And he'd say, let me land this. Oh, man. And so by the third time, I said, well, in a few minutes, Larry's going to land this. But let me just share with you. It was so awesome. But let me just one last thing. David White, he's one of our great poets. You should check out his stuff online. Born in Dublin, raised in England. And he was a poet, published poet by the age of 13. And he tells a story about how so he's become one of our great poets of our time. If you read his stuff, it's unbelievable. But he saw Jacques Cousteau. He left poetry because he saw Jacques Cousteau go floating across the screen of his television set. Black and white. And he said, wait a minute. You can make a living? He asked his mom. You can make a living floating around on a boat following dolphins? And he said for years, he never wrote poetry again. He put himself right. He says, like a poet, the salt mines of science and ends up with his PhD in zoology and ends up on the Galapagos Islands And for 2.5 years, there he is on the Galapagos Islands, and he's just studying, he's gazing, he's contemplating, right? Looking just a little further at creation, and then writing what he sees and taking people on journeys through that place. And then he says, after about 2.5 years on the Galapagos Islands, studying creation, I realized, he says, I went back to poetry because I felt like scientific language wasn't precise enough to describe the experiences that I had in Galapagos. Science, rightly, is always trying to remove the I. But I was really interested in the way that the I began to deepen the more I paid attention.
Come on.
So we just push into that because we do need to get rid of narcissism in our society. We do need to get rid of narcissism within worship. But I also see a lot of young people that are going to start coming to this university, and they're going to start writing songs that the world needs to hear. And I think a lot of times what we're doing is we're pushing. We've become a pop culture of praise and worship music, really. It's pop. And God wants to raise up poets, too, among us. God wants us to have a voice in our communities where we sing songs about raising family and life and marriage. Because let's not forget for 1 second that if we're not ever writing expressions about marriage, why are we going to stay married? If it doesn't matter enough to sing it, to feel that God's in it, if it's not sacred enough, right? I don't want to have to go to country music to feel the sacredness of marriage. I should be able to sit right in a church and sense the sacredness of marriage, right? And we should be able to have it in our songs and raising family and raising children and how we see God differently because of that. God is present to places that not only are we not present to yet ourselves, but God is present to places in us that we're just flat out uncomfortable with. So God, Lord, you're the great comforter, Holy Spirit. Thank you that this has always been a place of life. Thank you that this has always been a place of acceptance and kindness to me and my family. And I know this is a safe place to share this kind of message, but also we know that God, there's something bigger out there that you're calling us all to. There's new levels, there's new spaces that you're calling us into. God, we long for that. Give us the courage for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
So good. So I'm not sure which plane I should try to land here. I don't know about you. I got so much. Jason, thank you. He was just like flying out on this one and flying out on this one. I think I got about 4 sermons, maybe 5. Just, I was putting stars on these little seed ideas that if he'd had about 5 hours, he could have fully unpacked. But I think the message is stand up. That's not the message. I'm just singing. I want to give you hope that the end is coming soon, okay? It's like the guy with the billboard, the end is coming, okay? But I just want to say that God really, absolutely loves you. And he loves your humanity. And one of the things that was roaming through my mind was the Bob Dylan song, I ain't looking to compete with you, beat or cheat or mistreat you, simplify you, classify you, deny, defy, or crucify you. All I really want to do, and I'll improve on Bob's lyrics, is, beloved, walk with you. Amen? So I just pray, this gives you confidence to go after God in your unique way, but you'll find him in scripture. You'll find him in that kind of taking time to listen and then expressing it through action, through service. And It's just good. I could get saved again if, you know, if you just want to keep going, Jason, you know, another 2 hours, I'll be a puddle. And some of you, you know, isn't it true? I mean, my heart got wrecked yesterday listening to a bluegrass song called The Last Pew of the Church. I don't know why. It's so unfamous, you can't find it in all the search engines. But it destroyed me. In a good way, I was weeping that God hears our prayers.
Come on.
I'm telling you, there's some good stuff out there in normal stuff.
That's right.
So I just want to bless you that you're carrying the glory of God because God has chosen to accompany you. He's chosen to live inside you. If you don't know him and you have any time left, you can come up here and give your life to him because he's given his life for you. And the rest of you, I just want to bless you. And I just say, may the love of God the Father be with you. May the grace, the joyful enablement of Christ be with you and saving you more and more every day. And may the communion, the participation of the Holy Spirit be upon your life as you live for the glory of God. In the name of Jesus, I bless you, release you. Can we just give God an honor with an applause, with a shout? We love you. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for becoming human so that we could sort of understand who God is. Amen, amen. God bless you. Ministry team, if you'd come forward, there's always healing here. If you came hoping someone would pray for you, you will get breakthrough. There's healing here, I can tell you that. In his presence. Amen, amen.